Todd Mason of RouteOne was one of our thought leaders highlighted earlier this year in Subprime Auto Finance News as part of our package that we dubbed Trailblazers, Innovators, and Disruptors. Todd joined RouteOne more than 3 years ago and has developed a wide array of technology-based products during his career, and he's going to take us through some of the market trends among those tech-savvy Generation Z buyers who are budget-conscious and want to get the most for their money. So please help me welcome an industry trailblazer, Todd Mason of RouteOne.
Thank you, Nick. A trailblazer, wow, that sounds kind of scary. Pretty high expectations for that. Well, thank you for joining me this afternoon. I'm going to talk, as Nick said, about the evolution of automotive retail. 2 seconds on RouteOne, if you don't know who we are. Among a number of things, we are a credit aggregation platform. We serve about 18,000 dealers nationwide, including new and used. We have about 1,300 finance sources, banks, credit unions, captives, et cetera, as part of our network, and 130 dealer service provider integrations, the whole alphabet soup, DMSs, CRMs, et cetera. And there's a lot of companies out there that say they pride themselves on service. We absolutely pride our service on service as well, and we hope to get it right. We invest a lot of time, a lot of money, and a lot of effort so that when you make a phone call, we're there to pick it up. When you're there on a busy Saturday afternoon, our systems are up and running and helping you do what you need to get done. So with that little bit of introduction, I'm gonna dive right into it with a confession. One of my worst professional failings happened about 10 years ago. I was responsible back then for redeveloping a new human resource online system. And I've been in and around technology for nearly all my working career. I cut my teeth programming. I did user support, network support. I managed IT. I built products, built companies. So I've got a lot of scars on my back, to say the least. But this one in particular probably stung the most because it was a lesson that I've had to learn way too many times. Now, the software package had a strong, loyal user base. They liked the system. They were happy with it. The problem was the system was aging. We weren't as competitive as we used to be with it. We were losing business. The technology was so old, it was starting to get very difficult to maintain and upgrade. So we needed to do something with it. And so we did the things that we thought were right, that I thought were right. We did the planning. We did the design. We did the development. We did the testing. And then we went out to the marketplace, and not surprisingly, it failed. And it failed because we designed it around us. We didn't design it around our customers. And that's really the central theme that I want to talk to you today about, is by focusing in on the consumer, by focusing on the customer, a lot of good things happen and a lot of good things follow. And so what's driving the evolution of automotive retail? I think it's these three forces. It's sales models, the way that you sell cars. It's the industry infrastructure. This is the technology, the people, the regulation, the disruptors that are coming into the marketplace, and it's consumer behavior. And we'll talk a little bit more about each one of these things as we go through the presentation. So in the sales model, back in the old day, the traditional model, dealers controlled the entire sales process. If a customer wanted to be able to buy a car, they had to go to the dealer to find about the make, the model, the price, the options, and so on. If they wanted to do comparison shopping, they had to visit 5, 6, 7 dealers down the strip to find out to do that comparison shopping. Fast forward to today, the consumer is in control. Why are they in control? Because of the access to information that they have. Whether that's the OEM website, third-party website, et cetera, there is no lack of information available to them. And as a result, they are more and more in control of the buying process. And the final thing is the emerging. I don't think any of us know exactly where the future will go, but there are a number of interesting things that are happening, like on-demand, shared ownership, subscription-based services, and more to come. In fact, in today's newspaper that they delivered to all of us, they announced a new Lyft and a new Uber service where you can pool with other people coming from the airport or wherever it may be. And these things just are going to keep coming and coming and coming and coming as they build out these new emerging sales models that you're going to have to adapt to and leverage to some in some capacity. The next is industry infrastructure. We'll start with systems and processes. These are your dealer service providers, the integrations to make all the things work, and your employees with their skills and their behavior. So are these things, are they rooted in the past? Or are they building the capabilities? Are they building the skills to take you to where you need to go into the future? Security, legal, and compliance. The world will probably change a little bit based on the last election. But security, legal, compliance, they're here to stay. They may ebb and flow over time based on who's in office, but overall, these things are here to be with us and are part of our business model moving forward. And the final thing in this area are the disruptors. There are so many cropping up every single day, and you've heard of them, you know who they are. They're the companies that are trying to sell used vehicles in vending machines. They're the ones that are trying to sell an entire vehicle on a mobile phone. These are the guys that are trying to change the world. And it's a little bit like whack-a-mole right now. You're seeing tons and tons of them rise up, and we're seeing tons and tons of them disappear. And that's gonna happen, but there are gonna be a number of them that actually make it and start changing the industry. The thing to look out for them are kind of, what is their motivation? And I'll talk more about this as we go through. What's their motivation? Are they an enabler for you? As you're considering these disruptors, as you're considering dealer service providers, what's their motivation? Are they an enabler for you? Are they helping you better serve your customer, better engage with your customer? Or are they acting as a middleman trying to get in the middle between you and your customer and effectively sell your customer back to them? Understanding the motivation is incredibly important as you need to make the decisions, not just for today, but in the future. And the final force that's driving the evolution of automotive retail is consumer behavior. And we'll start off with the digital experience. Think of it as the Amazon effect. You all, I know I certainly do, buy at Amazon all the time. And as we as consumers become more and more comfortable with that, we start to expect that not just on Amazon, but in everything that we do, including buying a car. The next piece is ubiquitous access. And basically what that means is we all have access to the internet almost wherever we go, whether that's on our phone, our tablet, our PC, whatever it is, there is no lack for getting access to the internet. You can get it wherever you are. And the final thing is the breadth of options. Consumers, just like they have tons and tons of information available to them, they have lots of options, whether it's dealers, OEMs, finance sources, or third parties. And the dealers, they have choices in terms of where they choose to do business and also where they choose not to do business. So what's the underlying thread behind all of these three forces? It's the customer. Whether it's the relationship, the buying history, demographics, their finance and credit history, or their overall preferences. The customer is the central thing that's holding all of this together and where we need to keep our focus. So what's the path forward? The path forward are these four things. It's being at the right place for your customers, whether that is on the mobile phone, whether that's on the online, your dealership. It's being at the right place. And wherever your customer is, it's delivering the right experience based on where they are and based on what they want. The third piece is delivering the right relationships. It takes an army, as you well know, just about to sell a car. Think about all the technologies that are in place, all the people that are in place, the suppliers, everything that go into selling a car. There's a lot of complexity in your selling process. That complexity ought not reveal itself to your consumers. And it ought to be easy for them, and it should be focused on between you and them. The fourth piece is delivering the right choices. And the right choices for today are going to be a lot different than the right choices for tomorrow. So I know this is a lot easier said than done, and I'll hopefully provide a little bit of insights in each of these four areas moving forward. So what does it mean to be in the right place? Well, it means meeting customers where they are, anytime, any place, on any device. This is important because customers expect a seamless experience across the entire life cycle of buying a car, buying and owning a car. The opportunity for you is to lay the foundational elements needed to deliver an omnichannel experience. And what are those foundational elements? I think and hope they're the things that you would expect. It's a good website. It's a good credit application. It's a good way for your customers to be able to engage with you online and on mobile devices. And the outcome, if you lay those right foundational pieces in place, is to meet current expectations, which is important. A lot of this stuff is not happening tomorrow. It's happening right now. And you can't do it because someone said you have to do it. You have to do it because it's part of your overall strategy for gaining business today and tomorrow. So laying down these foundations takes care of where the market is today, but also paves the way for what's to come. So imagine if you didn't have a good website. Imagine if you didn't have a good mobile presence. Imagine if you didn't have a good way for you to interact with your customers in a digital fashion. If you don't get that right today, you're sure in the heck aren't going to get it right tomorrow. So let's take a look at three consumers. These are completely made up, but they should feel pretty familiar to you. The first is Bob. He's our traditional buyer. His focus is on price. He's been buying cars the same way for the past 20 years, and he's going to continue buying cars the same way until he gets his last one. He's focused on price. He's absolutely a traditional buyer. His preferred channels are paper and face-to-face. He's willing to roll up his sleeves and do a little bit more to pay less. Mary's in the middle. Mary's a soccer mom. She's very busy. She values her time. She's got a foot in the digital world, and she's got a foot in the paper world. She views technology as a way to help her save time, as a way to help her be more efficient. And she's willing to pay a little bit more to save time. And then we have Andy. Andy is our all-in guy. He's all about the experience. Not just about the experience of buying the car, but the experience of owning a car and having you as his dealership. Through the buying process, the service process, and when it all starts over again. And he wants to be able to access you all the time, anytime. Why do I bring these up? Well, I bring them up because they represent three very unique customer journeys, three very unique customer approaches and preferences. These are only three. There are hundreds. There are thousands of them out there. So as you're thinking about the customer experience that you want to build, there is no single one right answer. There is no one size fits all. You have to develop an experience that meets Bob, who's the traditional buyer that you've known for so many years, Mary, Andy, and so on and so on and so on. It's all about flexibility and keeping these people in the backs of your minds as you're building out your strategies. Which takes us to the next piece, and it's giving the right experience through personalization and relevancy. So this is consistent pricing. This is giving the same answer whether your customer starts on a mobile device or walks in the front door. This is about compliant, secure financing, and that's important because it builds trust throughout the entire process. People wouldn't buy from Amazon if they didn't trust that Amazon was going to take care of their credit card and all their financial information that they plug in to make the purchases. The financing is extremely important. The next piece is a complete purchase transaction. Now, I know right now, today, it's unlikely that someone's going to be able to buy a car completely online. There's probably very few that would actually want to do it. This is about laying down the capabilities because if not today, you know this is where the industry is heading. And some consumers like Bob will never use it. Consumers like Mary will use pieces of it. And Andy, he'll use all of it. And so you got to get pieces like that in place. And the next piece is digital flow of data and documents. And this is important because it drives consistency across all the channels that your customers want to use. And the outcome is to deliver an experience that customers actually want, including one that's transparent and tailored to their specific needs and wants. This is a bit of an eye candy chart, but I do it on purpose because it gives a sense of the complexity. So whether the consumer starts off on an OEM website or a third-party website, your website's filling out a credit application, walks in your front door, is interacting with you with an online messaging, or is signing the final contract in an iPad, these things need to hang together. These things need to feel unified. They need to feel like they're coming from you to deliver that right experience, to deliver what your customers want. All too often, what I've seen is dealers dealing with their online channel, and that's one silo, and their in-store channel is another silo, and they don't work together. And one of the worst case examples that I've run into, I was meeting with a dealer, and I asked her about her online credit application. And I said, well, and it was through a competitor. And I said, well, how's that working out for you? And she said, well, I don't know, because the guy that was managing it for us left the dealership a few weeks ago. She had no idea what service provider she used. She had no idea where that data was going, whether it was being protected at all. And of course, they were losing every single opportunity that went in through that online channel because no one was managing it. That's because they were managing it as silos versus one complete overall consumer experience. So deliver the right relationships. This is about leveraging your ecosystem. And what does your ecosystem mean? It means your people, the people in your shop and the people that you work, and the vendors that you work with, the dealer service providers. It's about your processes, your tools, your technologies, your products and services. And this is important because consumers view the buying transaction as one seamless thing. They don't view you, your OEM, if you're dealing with CPOs, and the finance source as separate entities. They view you as one. That's one transaction for them. Don't let the complexity of that transaction reveal itself to them, because what they want is a seamless support across the entire transaction. and blending those numerous relationships into you as the primary relationship. And the outcome is a more cohesive process that better matches the consumer's view of the world. That's their view. They view it as one transaction. They don't care how many people are involved in the back end. It's one transaction. It's one relationship to them. So it matches what they want. And as a result, if you get this right, it creates a stickier relationship with you as a result, which means more business, repeat sales, and so on. So what does that look like? There are some great examples of some leaders out in the marketplace. And I don't want to tout RouteOne, but RouteOne is one of them. And we're leading the charge with e-contracting. Last year, we processed about 2.5 million e-contracts. This year, it'll be nearly 3 million. And that's important because if you want to be able to conduct a transaction completely electronically, if you want to be able to deliver a vehicle completely remotely and have all the documents signed digitally, e-contracting is incredibly important. And it's also important because it pulls together your lease, your retail, aftermarket, all the various paperwork, various pieces of paper that make up your deal jacket into one seamless workflow for your customers. So that's an important piece. GM, with their Shop, Click, Drive program, is leading the charge in terms of trying to figure out the future of how consumers are going to buy cars online. And they're working towards that. Are very many consumers actually going through the entire process and buying a car online? Probably not. But I know enough about the data that I know it's driving lots of business to the dealers that are part of Shop, Click, Drive. And importantly, it's giving GM lots and lots of great learnings about how customers want to interact online. That's helping them lay the foundation for now and for what's to come. And the final piece I want to share is Sonic. Sonic is doing, a great job here. Because they're doing a great job because they're taking a holistic view. They understand it's not just about putting technology in place. It's just not bringing the forklift up and throwing the computer on the floor and saying, boom, we're done. Our strategy is we've completed our strategy. They're taking a much larger view. They've updated the way their stores look. They certainly have updated their technology, and they've also updated their people. And speaking with one of their vice presidents who's in charge of Echo Park, one of the things that he revealed to me was it's about the people that they hire and the people that they retain. And when they launched Echo Park, one of the things that they told their people is, either get on board or you get off board. And they actually had to let people go because they didn't get it. They didn't buy into the new sales process. So thinking about these things holistically is important. And Sonic got it right there. So the last piece is providing the right choices. And that's about flexible systems. That's about data availability and consistency. And it's about deep integrations. And this is important because evolving consumer behaviors are already having a dramatic impact on the industry and will have an even more dramatic impact as we move forward. And so the opportunity for you is to create flexible systems. And again, this is one of those things, all of this is much easier said than done. But think about your ecosystem. This is really where it comes into play in choosing the right partners that do a couple of things. One, understanding the motivations. Are they coming to the table as an enabler or as a middleman trying to steal your customer relationship? I think the enabler is who you want. Are they making the right investments? Not just to take care of what you need right at the moment, but making the right investments so that as you build out, as you grow, as the industry changes, consumer behavior changes, and are their systems adopting and changing and growing along with it? And the third piece is about integrations. To me, technology to an extent is a commodity. What makes it not a commodity is the way that you put those pieces together. And integrations are an important part of that. Are you working with vendors? Are you working with dealer service providers that are willing to work together to integrate data so that it can move from point A to point B to point C and back and forth and all over the place? Having the right partners is incredibly important. And the outcome of creating flexible systems is being the ability to be able to lay multiple bets. I said it earlier, and I hope you hold it as true as I do. I don't think anyone knows what the future is going to be. We see a lot of tea leaves. We see a lot of things up coming up and going down and going all over the place. So we've got some ideas what's to come, but none of us know exactly what it's going to be. And there's not going to be a single answer. So having flexibility so you can lay multiple bets for whatever might come is important. So I'm going to finish where I began. And the path forward is again, easier said than done, but it's centered on your customers. So whether it's the sales models moving from traditional to the omni-channel to the emerging sales models that are happening today, the changes in the industry with the infrastructure, changes in regulation, the growth of security attacks, disruptors and so on, your technology, your people, or consumer behavior. Those are all things that are factoring into what Bob and Mary and Andy are doing and your ability to be at the right place, delivering the right experience, providing the right relationship, and the right choices for what customers actually want to buy and the way that they want to buy it. So with that, I'll be happy to take any questions if we have time. I think we have about 5 minutes.
And great job, Todd. Thank you so much for the great foundational layering there to improve strategies and sharpen skills. I guess perhaps to get a conversation started again is how crucial is it to not presume any specific attributes about your customer base, as you articulated, that not presuming that the older gentleman perhaps would be afraid of technology, where there might be someone who of that demographic that would embrace it, or vice versa. What are some perhaps best practices to look at the customer base and to go forward from there?
I think part of the answer was in the question that you asked, and that is, don't make assumptions. Know your customers. You have an incredible amount of data stored in your DMS, your CRM, and all the other systems that really no one else has like you do. Use that data to help you understand your customers, where they live, where they work, what their ages are, what their buying preferences are. No one else has that kind of asset to realize what's about your customers. Do studies of them. Take a look at data that's in the marketplace. One of the most interesting pieces of study, and I haven't seen it repeated elsewhere, was a study on millennials. And it talked about the assumption that millennials only want the digital experience. So if you get the digital experience, they don't want to talk to you, they don't want to see it. Well, the study said that's not quite true. They like the digital channel. They want to be able to do the research. They're very skeptical, so that's why the research to them is so important. But at the end of the day, they really value that face-to-face experience, that face-to-face touch point, because that's ultimately what brings the trust in the transaction. So don't make assumptions. Do your own studies. In particular, look at your own data.
Closing moments here with Todd Mason from RouteOne. Perhaps if a company already has a strategy in place that perhaps they're not satisfied with, what perhaps maybe would be a suggestion is to kind of hit that reset button, so to speak, to reevaluate what processes maybe were in place. What are maybe some tips to analyze what they've already been doing as a way to modify what might be already in place?
I wish there were a silver bullet, but I can tell you when I get that question as RouteOne, and we get it fairly frequently, we know that dealers are doing this, not just with us, but with many others. Ask your vendors, ask your dealer service providers, especially the ones that you trust, what are your strategies? What are you seeing out the marketplace? Talk to them about your strategy and where you see the world going, and bounce it off of them. A lot of the expertise is in the vendors, are in the dealer service providers that you use. Leverage that to the extent that you can. At times it might turn into a sales pitch. The better vendors won't, but use them. And of course, there's lots of good research out there. One of the best pieces of research that is a go-to for me is Deloitte is doing a lot of good research in and around the future of automotive finance, as well as the future of automotive retail. And they've got at least two or three white papers that are out there, and I think they're going to build about to about a dozen of them. So a lot of good white papers and research out there, and I suggest Deloitte is one of them.
You mentioned in your presentation talking about tea leaves, and we're all always trying to look forward. Just in your own segments, just as we approach a new year, we're only about six to 8 weeks away from 2017 officially being here. Just what's on your radar to just either for your capacity at RouteOne or on a personal professional level, what's on your radar to watch in the new year?
Wow. Execution, I think, is probably what's most on my personal radar right now. The anytime, any place, any device message that I shared earlier is absolutely top of mind for me. When I was at NADA earlier this year, it was a message that's common in the industry, and everyone out in the out there is trying to do some flavor of it. So when I'm looking at what we're doing, when I'm looking at what others are doing, it's how are they putting the pieces together so that whether you're penciling, doing the first pencil, doing the aftermarket, doing the credit application, doing e-contracting, capturing a lead, how are all those pieces pulling together in a seamless fashion? How, not just with a single vendor, but how are those pieces coming together from multiple vendors? So execution is a big piece for me. Yes?
What's the best way to proceed with emails when we do blasts?
When you do blasts? One, I can tell you how we approach it, and I think it's best practice in general. It's realizing that sending an email message and having a customer open up is a privilege. Because it's a privilege, you have to hold the time and attention of your customer as of highest importance. And so how you manage that is making sure that you're sending out emails that matter to them, not just matter to you, but matter to them. And a lot of that is your goals are going to align. They want to save money on their next oil change. They want to save money on their next vehicle. But make sure it's not just about you, and when you send out those emails, they align with what you think that they want. And don't send that out every day, once a month, whatever it is. Just be cognizant of their time. That answer your question?
Yes. And another question I had is, when we have internet customers, some of our internet customers that deal on the internet only, they're not necessarily looking for pricing. They just want to have a one-on-one interaction with one of our salespeople that isn't involved with the normal shuffle of the, you know, just throw them the one side of the dealership, throw them the next side of the dealership. How do we better manage that? And how do we acknowledge who these particular people are and how to manage them?
I think to an extent it goes back to a couple of comments that I made earlier and the notion that many of us in the industry are viewing online and in the traditional world as two separate things. And so the handoffs are clunky at best, and I think that's what I'm hearing from you. And again, it's one of those things that are easier said than done, but that's really one thing. Customers don't, when they're sitting in your showroom, they're sitting in with their mobile phones, and as you're talking to them, they're looking at your website, they're looking at your competition's website. They're doing that because what they see on their phone when they're sitting in front of you versus the conversation that they're having with you, that's the same thing. They're not viewing it as a separate thing. So when you get an email or a contact online, that's the same thing as them walking into the store. And so I think breaking down those barriers between the internet side of your shop and the traditional side of your shop, that's easier said than done, but I think ultimately that's what needs to happen because that's just one seamless experience.
Well, excellent. Please, warm round of applause for Todd Mason of Route One. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your time.